Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr. Tonight's chairman, C. Dickerman Williams.
Ladies and gentlemen, our topic for discussion tonight is black power. Our guest is Mr. Nat Hentoff, a writer and frequent contributor to the New Yorker magazine. Our student guests tonight are from New York University, and they will participate in the discussion also. Will you proceed, Mr. Buckley?
Mr. Nat Hentoff is a writer and possibly the leading writer on American jazz, on which he reports regularly in the New Yorker magazine and in other magazines, to say nothing of books, encyclopedias, and almanacs.
May I say, in fairness to Whitney Balliet of the New Yorker, that's the one place I don't write on jazz.
Sorry. But he is greatly interested in politics, on which he also writes regularly, even though he is probably not the leading writer on that subject. He is especially interested in the Negro question and has written an eloquent book on a great teacher in a Harlem school called Our Children Are Dying, the thesis of which is that, fortunately, they're not. Mr. Hentoff is a Bostonian, a graduate with highest honors of Northeastern University, who has done postgraduate work at Harvard and at the Sorbonne, and has lectured all over the country. He is greatly involved in the radical movement. Indeed, he is so radical as to express imperfect satisfaction with Bobby Kennedy. He thinks we should probably have a third party whose candidate for the presidency would be Dr. Benjamin Spock. And perhaps before then, a constitutional convention would be in order, giving the vote to babies. we must also, he writes, have black power to overcome white power. Mr. Hentoff, the definition of black power is rather footloose these days. Do you have a favorite definition?
I would say that, to use a currently popular, if also parlous term, that the consensual definition is very simple, that black power is the hope that Negroes in this country can first organize themselves and then thereby utilize their capacities, their resources in terms of numbers, in terms of economic potential, political potential and the like, so that finally they can have some decision-making power in terms of the society at large and, more to the immediate point, in terms of the neighborhoods and the schools in which the neighborhoods in which they live and the schools in which their children are miseducated.
Well, who do you understand yourself to be opposing when you advocate that particular sentiment? I mean, other than George Lincoln Rockwell or somebody.
I suppose primarily people, and I think primarily of the editors of the New York Times as a sort of example, mm-hmm. who seem unable to understand exactly what black power means. It does not exist as yet, which I think rather unfortunate, but I still don't understand the furor over the call for black power that started last summer and has seemed to have died down a bit since then.
Well, could it be because it's understood by different people as meaning different things? If you hear, say, Elijah Muhammad coming out for black power, then you tend to associate it with an essentially racist doctrine.
You are tuned in to Firing Line, and we'll return in a moment.
Let me ask you this, Mr. Hentoff. What do those people who oppose black power understand it to mean? I mean, people that you more or less approve of.
Well, I try in most cases to try role reversal, but it's hard for me to understand, or rather to separate the emotional reaction from what it is they actually do think. I assume, and again I cite the Times and let's say the New York Post, which in this instance is rather consonant with the Times, I suppose they think of the doctrine as a racist doctrine, and the corollary concern seems to be that thereby Negroes will alienate their good white friends and make things much more difficult for the coalition, that luminous coalition of labor and the church and civil rights groups and the like, which is apparently about to end the final verse of We Shall Overcome, which never seems quite able to do that.
What is the final verse?
No, I mean which will put the song to an end. Whereas I think the black power advocates, and on the face of it, obviously, using that term literally and figuratively, it's somewhat presumptuous of me to talk about black power, but I'm here. Mm-hmm. I think the most advocates of black power believe that the civil rights movement, as exemplified, let's say, by the kind of spirit that We Shall Overcome had, which was a quite noble period, I think, though short, is at an end. And that now, after the civil rights laws have been passed and after the public accommodations difficulties have been more or less resolved in most states, it's a post-civil rights period which has to deal with very radical in the terms of getting to the root problems of housing and education and jobs and the like, and singing songs won't break those walls down.
Well, what will?
Well, I'm not always sanguine that much will, at least in the foreseeable future, but one possibility is black power in the sense, again, well, let's say in a Negro community. My own feeling is, and I try to indicate this in the book, Our Children Are Dying, that one basic change that has to come is an education. Because in the kind of society that now exists and will increasingly exist with cybernation and all, the kind of education that most poor children get in slum schools pretty much determines that their lives in this country, in this society, are going to be substandard by any of the criteria that, let's say, the majority uses. However, the schools in the ghettos, by and large, are not accountable to the people whose children are in those schools. The New York City school system recently, after some resistance over the years, published the reading scores of the public school system. And to no one's surprise, the reading scores in the ghetto schools were substantially, rather alarmingly lower than those in middle class and upper middle class neighborhoods. Now, one thing that black power, if it were operative, which it isn't now, might accomplish is a kind of committee, let us say, of parents from the neighborhood, working with people from nearby universities, working with, if you like, an ombudsman for education hired by the local parent body, which would, and also, I would hope, working with the United Federation of Teachers, which is rather laggard in the sense of realizing that the schools must be made accountable to the parents, that this kind of committee might indeed do something about the education in the ghetto schools, because the Board of Education in New York City has lost, it seems to me, the trust of most of the parents in ghetto communities for very good reason.
Well, one of the reasons that I'm perhaps as baffled as other people in trying to understand your critique, and that of so many other people, is because I'm never quite sure whether black power means that the desideratum is simply the use of a lever, or the maximization of the leverage, if you prefer, mm-hmm. or whether there is inbuilt into that some sort of a concept. Now, for instance, there is black power in Ghana, isn't there? Mm-hmm. But not a hell of a lot of progress by your standards or mine. So therefore, pure political power isn't in and of itself enough. It's political power united with certain concepts, with a certain ethos that you and I feel that we want to push. Now, you hear somebody like James Baldwin, and he says the only thing the white man has that the Negro should want is power, meaning that he explicitly disdains the criteria, the value system of the white community. Now, if that is the case, don't we have a paradox that on the one hand, people who are urging the Negro community to take power often find themselves urging the Negro community not to use that power in order to pursue goals or adapt to a value system which the white community has adapted to. And we find people like yourself who I think rather sincerely hate this country, hate its value systems, really hoping that black power will somehow metamorphose into a different kind of a society, which, however, the perimeters of which, the dimensions of which, you're not very successful in describing, are you?
Well, I don't even begin with that illusion. I think you're right that a number of the advocates of black power, and Baldwin certainly among them, have the belief that out of some kind of, I won't say mystical, but some kind of purgative or cleansing momentum, black power will indeed make the values toward which the Negro community aspire not the values of the American society as a whole, which you're right. I don't know as I hate this country. I'm not really nationalistic even in my negative feelings. I think that the kind of values that operate here operate as well in Ghana, so far as I know, and in many other countries throughout the world. But what I'm trying to say here is I think if those people who do have that feeling that this will happen are going to find themselves somewhat disappointed, because I think it's unrealistic not to see that most Negroes do indeed want the values that are the prevailing middle-class values here, at least in the sense of decent housing, the possibility that their children can have the kind of job that that will bring pride both to them and to their families. And I think it's rather presumptuous, to say the least, for anybody to say these are no good. It seems to me if you believe in, let's say, participatory democracy, that's for the people involved to decide for themselves. So I try, I don't do any urging in any case, except in terms of writing, but I try to separate my criticism, you know, of the
how
value structure.
How else does one urge except in writing?
Well, I was thinking in terms of, well, like A.J. Mustey used to do, go out on the street and do demonstrations and the like. Mm-hmm. But I try to separate what I would like to see happen from my own point of view, which may not have anything to do with what other people want, with what I think most Negroes do want, which is a chance into this society. I would indeed like to see the society change, but my own priorities, I think, are not really to the point here.
Yeah, but here you get a very interesting question, one that I think does very considerably disturb a lot of extremely sincere friends of the Negro people, and that is that so many people who are urging black power, although they are willing to say yes, as you just said, obviously they want, we all want better housing and better education and so on, still we want to aim for a society which somehow transmutes the old vulgar society into which we have grown up as sort of a dirty and infested bourgeois into something much more interesting and noble, and that under the circumstances, the techniques which are apposite for the realization of that kind of society have got to take this very much into account. You hear, for instance, Bayard Rustin, as you recently commented, saying that the Negro community and the civil rights community has got to side with a, quote, radical reformation of the American society. And you thought this was terrific, you know.
Bayard is considered these days rather conservative.
I know, yes. Yeah, that's right, curiously, yeah. In the last 18 months or so.
Yeah.
And yet, an awful lot of people who are willing to do everything that they can to advance the cause of any minority are not willing to transform a society, the general shape of which they tend rather to approve of. Mm-hmm. And might this not be a reason why there is the kind of opposition to black power which every now and then you find out?
Nat Hentoff and William F. Buckley, Jr. will return to their positions on the firing line in just a moment.
Mr. Hentoff, would you answer Mr. Buckley's last question?
Yeah, as I understood the question, it's essentially a fairly recurrent question about tactics. Don't the tactics that are involved in either the urging of black power or the rhetoric of black power, although Bayard Rustin is not an advocate of black power in the sense we're talking about tonight, but you quoted him as saying that there had to be a radical reformation of society. The question, as I take it, was doesn't this language tend to alienate sincere friends of the Negro? Well, I think what is generally felt now is that it really doesn't matter if whites are alienated, because of the fact that, you see, at the beginning of the civil rights movement, which after all is hardly that old in its present manifestation, starting in 1960, there was a carryover of the old Eisenhower and New York Times editorial point of view of the 50s that change in the hearts of men was going to accomplish the opening of the society to the Negro. And Part of the We Shall Overcome spirit still had some of that. Sure, everybody was out on picket lines and sit-ins and freedom rides, but there was some hope of conversion, of awakening moral consciousness. Even Baldwin, after all, why else did he write The Fire Next Time, if not to address the whites and exacerbate their consciences? And the feeling now seems to be that this doesn't do it, and that what if there is any hope, it's going to be counterpower. And that's going to start, if it does indeed start, by at least having Negroes in their own communities have some say, in, again, in how they live and how they work and how their schools are educated. So the concern really isn't anymore with keeping the white folks friendly. And it seems to me a realistic point of view.
Well, is this in a sense, an argument against the integrationist premises of the meliorists, mm-hmm. of the past civil rights generation, if you like, i.e., are you saying something that has been sort of hinted at by Moynihan and Glaser and by others, namely, that it may be that the notion of a general sort of a mobile in which everybody is raised up as a result of the healthy juices of the society is not in fact working out, and that under the circumstances we can actually learn something from the separatist rhetoric of Elijah Muhammad by urging sort of an autarkic, endogamous enthusiasm, economic and cultural, among people, which will give them the strength to overcome these particular obstacles. I know, for instance, I remember the datum in this particular book that the Chinese in New York City tend to patronize each other at 40 times the rate that the Negro community tends to patronize each other. Now, ideally, in terms of liberal ideals, one shouldn't patronize somebody because of race, color, or creed, whether positively or negatively.
Well, of course, that was the case.
Might it be that negatively it does, in fact, help?
That was the case for years and still is in large part among Jews in this country. I grew up in a Jewish ghetto in Roxbury, Massachusetts, and it was just taken as a dictum that, by and large, one patronized other, you know, Jewish stores and the like, and there was...
And it worked.
Well, it worked. It was also based, of course, on a centuries-old feeling, you know, that that Jews had utilized to hold themselves together against oppression and all kinds of societies.
Would you call that, quote, Jewish power?
Yeah, sure. It was called, in my day, Yiddishkeit, and the corollary of it was that if you said of somebody he had a Yiddish cup...
Yiddish what?
A Yiddish cup, a Jewish head. That meant because he was Jewish, he was smart, which didn't always happen to work out pragmatically. But the opposite of that was a Goyish cup, which had as its syllogism, because he was a Goy, he was stupid. But what I'm saying is that this feeling of Yiddishkeit, even when I was growing up in Boston, which was a time of fairly virulent anti-Semitism, Father Coughlin had many rather active, energetic admirers at the time. This kind of in-group feeling did help. I think it also does some harm as well, too, because you have, when you do go out into the wide world, you find out that these equations don't really work out that way.
Unfortunately, some people love you.
That's also a problem. I do think that, to go back to the beginning of your question, the whole feeling about integration certainly has changed somewhat, I think. And I think it's a sad development in the civil rights movement. Because the feeling now is that empirically, the possibility of real integration in the North, in the cities, seems so remote. Housing segregation patterns are so embedded. The workforce is so segregated. Because of bad education, the chances of broadening into that workforce are limited to only those relatively few Negroes who somehow get up through the system and go to college and get a degree. So the feeling now appears to be more and more, let us make the best of what we can in our own communities, both in terms of education and also in terms of political power.
Well, does that suggest that the emphasis on integration might not have been the correct emphasis in terms of achieving the goals that we desire?
That seems to be the position of Stokely Carmichael and Floyd McKissick.
Yeah, but is it yours? I know it's Carmichael's, yeah, but is it yours?
Well, if you're asking me if I would have... If I would have done differently or felt differently, I couldn't have, because my own ideal is integration for those who want it. Whether in retrospect I think it was the wrong approach, I think history, recent history, has indicated that it was, it seemed a possibility at the time. And I think a lot of us, I certainly were caught up with this feeling that if the hearts of men were not being moved, at least something was happening. After all, Paul Scrivain was marching in Selma.
Right.
You know,
right,
that sort of luminous, epiphanal event.
Yeah.
But then when it came to City Hall, it became very clear that, for example, there's a law in the city of New York that if the city enters into a contract with an employer or a labor union that discriminates, that contract can be canceled. Now, that's never happened. Mm-hmm. Never happened under Wagner. It has yet to happen.
They've never been canceled, or they never entered into such a contract?
No, they've entered into contracts with all the craft unions, most of which still discriminate.
Yeah.
This hasn't even happened under Lindsay
so far. So they're legally null and void, those contracts?
They could be, if the city wanted to move.
Yeah.
But when Herb Callender, who was at the time the Bronx head of CORE, tried a citizen's arrest of Mayor Wagner,
didn't work. Huh?
Not only didn't work, but he was immediately hastened to Bellevue, which was a rather sharp indication
did
of where it was at.
Did he survive that?
Yeah, I think he's still in CORE. I think it probably affected his views of integration somewhat.
Yeah.
Well, Ms. Buckley, we have a question for you.
Oh, this was going back earlier to the discussion about black power. Recently, while in New York, I was given a pamphlet by this group which represented black power. And the publication they put out was called Elijah Speaks. And in this, they asserted that in order to be given full rights, that the United States citizens should set up a state for them separately and support them for 25 years until they could get on their own feet. What would your opinion be concerning this?
In other words, do you believe in a separate state for Negroes?
Well,
a separate state, meaning a state comparable to New York, Massachusetts.
My impulse is very much opposed to it, because it seems to me, for the reasons I tried to suggest a moment ago, that black power in and of itself is not going to do anything more for the Negro community in America than it's done for the Ghanese community or the Liberian community in Africa. It's not political power that in and of itself takes care of the material problems of society. It's power combined with a particular ethos. And that particular ethos has done materialist wonders for people, for instance, in the United States and in various parts of the West. So if Elijah Muhammad were to succeed in isolating himself completely, in moving all the Negro community, let's say, to a black belt, you know, the old Bolshevik idea of the early 30s, it would not necessarily do anything for them unless they were motivated or animated by those principles and ideas that actually had succeeded in producing the kind of wealth that they seek in other places. Now, but the reason your question fascinates me and Mr. Hentoff's a commentary on more or less the dissolution of the integrationist ideology is that it may be that we are all, in a sense, indebted to Elijah Muhammad for retracing our way back to the Jewish experience, the Chinese experience, the Irish experience, and the rest of it, which suggests that it is important for any particular oppressed minority to use its resources. And the way it uses its resources is becoming highly self-conscious, recognizing what power it has potentially economically, politically, culturally, and the rest of it, and using that power. That's the kind of black power I'm in favor of being used.
What do you think of that proposal, Mr. Hentoff, to have a separate state for the Negroes?
Well, it's characteristic
of a series of states.
It's characteristic of Elijah Muhammad, which is one of the reasons why, although he had the beginnings of a following, of what might have been a sizable following, particularly when Malcolm X was his chief organizer, I think his movement, the Muslim movement, has become essentially unimportant, and what it really was always, a sect. But in response to what Mr. Buckley was saying, part of the thrust toward black power is indeed a feeling of the generation of a feeling of pride, a pride in black roots in this country. And that's why there's such an emphasis in getting different kinds of textbooks into the schools and into countering, for example, the advice of Whitney Young to Negro parents a couple of years ago that Negro parents should uplift their progeny by having them hear Bach and Beethoven and go to ballet instead of listening to the blues and boogie-woogie.
Forgive me for interrupting at this point. Our topic is Black Power, and this is Firing Line, and we'll return in a moment.
Mr. Hentoff, I think you were in the midst of an answer.
I was saying that part of the thrust toward Black Power is the awakening, or the somehow helping young Negroes particularly awaken to the fact that the history of the black man in this country and before this country in Africa was hardly what one gathers from most textbooks even now. That, for example, in this country, contrary to Whitney Young, there is a rich, complex musical heritage in jazz and the blues and the like, which is in fact pervasively influencing all of folk and folk rock music this very day throughout the world. That, as Ralph Ellison points out in a very valuable essay in Shadow and Act, a collection of his essays, there are Negro American styles, ways of wit, ways of timing. I don't mean all God's children got rhythm, but ways of observing and utilizing what you observe in terms of kinetic action and the like. And that this is, again, a very rich history about which not too much yet has been written about, but which materials could be used in all classrooms, of course, not only in slum schools, but certainly in ghetto schools. And that's why I see in more and more places around the country there, since the textbooks don't have them, the teachers themselves begin to generate materials on African history and on Afro-American history here in this country, so that the kids get out of school, and this is a point Baldwin made years ago, not having the white man's definition of them, but their own definition of themselves and their history, which is an attempt really to get a what was Yiddishkeit among Jews.
Yeah, but it doesn't, we have a question for you from a student here. Yeah,
can I just add this? It doesn't, I hope, in order to encourage this racial pride, require the kind of antagonism towards the white culture that Mr. Baldwin does tend to harp on?
I think it probably will operate in that sense for some people for some period of time, because you cannot take out of the Negro's experience in this country a feeling of rage, bitterness, whatever. There are Jews still who cannot bear to have the German language spoken.
Yeah, but we deplore this, do we not?
We deplore it, but I understand it. I don't fall into that because I had no relatives or anybody I knew killed in a concentration camp, but my mother in Russia used to hide in the kitchen stove from marauding Cossacks. And as a result, she did not trust any Gentile of any nationality to the day she died. And nothing could dissuade her, and I understood that.
Well, your mother was irrational. And
she almost had her head cut off.
Sure. And lots of Catholics have been killed by lots of Protestants.
But you can call it irrational, but it exists.
And we don't want to encourage it, though. We don't want to make the people our bards who encourage us to keep this kind of prejudice in our bones, do we?
Well, I don't know as you can really determine who the bards are.
Yeah, but Baldwin does this kind of thing, doesn't he? His point really is that the white culture is metaphysically tainted, and that under the circumstances it is impossible for us ever to expunge our guilt. What we have to do is simply throw away the United States and start from scratch.
Well, of course, the problem is that all cultures that interact, and this is the case in this country, become tainted one against the other. But, you know, this does happen, and all I can say is before there's going to be any real reconciliation between the races in this country, there's going to be a great deal more of tension, and if you call it irrationality, but a great deal of expression and release of anger. I think this is inevitable.
Could we have the student's question now?
Yes, Mr. Hentoff, I would be very interested to hear your opinion on the Adam Clayton power controversy in terms of black political power.
Well, if there were indeed black power now, I think that it would have manifested itself, but all we've had now are rallies and a terribly abortive one-day strike in Detroit. Inez Robb, as a matter of fact, the columnist, pointed out shortly after the Adam Clayton Powell event that black power could well have been utilized to get some intensive research into the peccadilloes of other congressmen, which were roughly comparable to those of Powell. Now, in terms of Powell...
Drew Pearson's not a Negro, is he?
Pardon?
Drew Pearson's not a Negro.
No.
He's hard at work, isn't he?
No, I think, that this, after all, this is one of Drew Pearson's main vocational predilections.
Are you implying that there has been under-application in this particular...
I'm saying that if there were indeed... In other words, what is going to extricate Adam Powell, if he is going to be extricated, is not going to be the kind of counterpower, the fear of Negro political vengeance at the polls that some commentators at the time, rather naively, I thought, predicted, because there is just not that kind of organization yet.
Do you know, Mr. Hentoff, here I'm really losing you, because as I understand your answer to the gentleman's question...
I haven't answered at all. You're asking
well,
what
Well, so far, as I understand it, you've been saying that what happened to Adam Clayton Powell is evidence that there isn't black power in this country, and yet Adam Clayton Powell was thrown out by something like, percentage-wise, 55% to 45% of the vote. Now, in my judgment, somebody who had as flagrantly as he denied authority, explicit and implicit, the courts of New York, or hell, even defied the New York Times, would have been thrown out like maybe 95-5, except for the fact that he had been nigger.
I don't think so. I really don't think so.
Well, can you give me an example of anybody whose quotes peccadillos were on that scale?
Well,
who got away with it?
If one is to believe Drew Pearson, there are a number.
Well, A1 isn't, and B...
But I would think, you know...
Dodd has never refused to answer questions.
I wasn't even thinking of Dodd.
He has never refused to appear before a judge. He's never even asked to appear before a judge. Neither the FBI nor the Justice Department has ever found anything wrong with it. There is a continuing investigation. Nobody has said he was guilty. Who are you thinking of?
I was thinking
Parnell
of the
Thomas?
Chairman of the
he
House...
Was thrown out from jail.
Well, yeah, but Parnell Thomas is...
White.
Yeah, but his actions were so unconscionable that there wasn't really much that
Why
could
so
be
unconscionable?
Done.
Why are they more unconscionable than Powell's?
Well,
wasn't he thrown out and put in jail?
Yes, he
was.
But
so
no,
he got a rebate. He got like $18 a week that didn't belong to him.
No, I'm still convinced that Powell, in fact, the general feeling, as one gathered from reports on the of reactions of congressmen, was not that Powell had been this defiant of the courts of New York State, or that he had misused credit cards and the like, but that he was arrogant, terribly arrogant. That was Emanuel Seller's diagnosis of the reason for this House almost hysteria on the Powell case, because they threw him out even before the Court of Appeals decision in New York State, which I don't think would have happened to another congressman. No, I think Powell very definitely was thrown out because, light as he is a Negro.
According to Edward Bennett, Williams' reasons Joe McCarthy was censured it was not because he roughed up a general, which is still permissible under the Constitution, but because he was, quote, arrogant. Now, he got it, and he got it rather definitively, and there wasn't a Negro question involved there. The reason I think the Adam Clayton Powell case is so interesting, I'm glad you brought it up, is because it seems to me to belie your thesis on two grounds. A, it shows that there is black power in the sense that that which normally would be done doesn't get done as a result of the restraints that people feel because they don't want to criticize somebody who is a Negro. And secondly, it belies your thesis in the sense that, in my judgment, the Adam Clayton Powell shows that that many people that you approve of, militants in the civil rights movement, tend to ask for the application of a double standard which precisely militates against the stimulation of that racial self-pride that you agree is necessary before we elevate the Negro to a position of total power.
Well, on the first part of your statement, it's a matter of judgment. I don't think either of us can prove it, but I'm still convinced that Powell would still be in Congress if he were white.
You really honestly?
I am honestly convinced
that?
Because, you know, after all, who done him in?
His wife.
I mean among elected officials.
And he's white.
It was a liberal, the man from California, and then seconded by Udall, who really got the machinery rolling. Frank Thompson, at one point, who was a liberal from New Jersey, could have stopped or mollified the action, but he got on the bandwagon, primarily because, as I understand it, there was such a rush of mail from their liberal constituency. Get this arrogant guy out.
I thought your point was that his arrogance did him in.
His arrogance as a black man.
In this case, it was he who had...
In other words, a certain amount of arrogance...
What if he'd been an arrogant Chinese?
Oh, I think he'd still be there, because the image of the Chinese in this society at present is not such as to stir fear.
We hate him because he travels first class. You know?
There's a certain amount of how come he thinks he's so uppity, being what he is.
We have another question for Mr. Hentoff.
Yes, Mr. Hentoff. I was curious about your statement that the Negro people, the advocates of black power, have abandoned the idea of a change in the hearts of men. It seems to me that this would be the only way that the Negro could possibly achieve equality in this country. And I was wondering whether or not black power might be another tactic to actually achieve a change in the hearts of men, or have you completely abandoned this idea?
Not abandoned, I think.
Before we get to that answer, Mr. Hentoff, I'd like to interrupt here to say that we are watching Firing Line with William F. Buckley, Jr., tonight's guest, Nat Hentoff, tonight's chairman, C. Dickerman Williams, and we will return in just a moment.
Mr. Hentoff, you are in the midst of answering a question as to whether or not you've given up the idea of a change in the hearts of men.
Of course, whether I have or not is rather irrelevant since we're talking about Negroes and black power. But I, as one sympathetic with
Negro aspirations.
I have not, but I think it's going to take a good long time. I think what the change essentially now is, in terms of those who advocate black power, is that there has to be a change in the hearts of black people first, in terms of their feeling that they themselves have the resources, the strength, the pride to create something of their own, to make their own decisions. And if this could, then can be done politically and insofar as possible economically, and that's rather difficult, then it may well be possible to have real coalitions with whites of whatever, you know, group or the like on specific issues. If, for example, you had a coalition to change the schools in a community, you would have to involve some white teachers in the United Federation of Teachers. If Walter Reuther's split from organized labor turns out to be what he purports it to be, a real return to active organizing and making organized labor, at least his part of it, a social force, one could see an ad hoc coalition between Negroes who want to break into organized labor and some of Reuther's people. But the point is that waiting for a change in the hearts of men is simply waiting, and the action has to start among Negroes themselves to see what power they can muster.
We have a question from Mr. Buckley.
So you said that you drew a parallel between the Negro and other ethnic minorities that have, you know, sort of risen out of the gutter in this country, the Jews, Italians, and so on, the Chinese. You don't think that the Negro faces special problems?
I do. That's why I didn't draw a parallel. All I said was that certain things might be learned. Let me restate this. I think it's extremely important to state it carefully. I think that the Negro labors under disadvantages infinitely in excess of those that the Jew or the Italian or the Catholic or whatever. And I think that Mr. Hentoff would agree. But I don't think that from this it follows that the Negro has nothing to learn from the Jew about the means by which the Jew effected his own emancipation. You do understand that distinction?
Yeah.
Yeah. So do you?
Yes. After all, I grew up in Boston under a period of glorious Irish power, which I enjoyed a great deal as a spectator.
You obviously won.
Not in Boston, really. The Kennedys are still doing quite well. But I grew up under James Michael Curley, for example, and that was a very instructive and entertaining example of how people, after all, could break through what was then the power structure, what Curley used to call, with great glee, the State Street Wrecking Crew, mm-hmm. which meant the Yankees. And that could only happen by mass block voting and a real ethos, an ethos of...
And it's interesting, isn't it, that in your home state, there are very few Negroes, aren't there? What, 3 to 4%?
Relatively few, certainly compared to New York.
Yeah, and it's especially interesting, considering that you wrote as recently as, what, a couple of months ago, quotes, most adult Americans are also racist, and therefore equality of opportunity is not going to be granted, that a community that's 96% white voted a Negro senator.
How do you reconcile that with your...
Oh, I think it's a fascinating development. I wish I was still in Massachusetts so I could do more than speculate from a distance. I think there are several factors involved.
I'll pay you the round trip.
All right. I think his opponent was hardly that charismatic. Not that Brooke is especially either, but he does have a presence. But I think it's more than that. First of all, Brooke is a very careful Negro. He has never been involved in civil rights activities. His feeling, and I'm sure it's genuine, is a feeling of reconciliation, integration. I don't think he ever believes in exacerbating tensions to get something solved. And also, and this may be invidious and unfair of me, it's been speculated by newspaper friends of mine in Boston, who I suppose notoriously are cynical, that this was a marvelous chance for Massachusetts to show the nation that it could lead in the post-Civil War period by sending someone far away from Massachusetts, because a senator from a state, and Leverett Saltonstall certainly bore this out admirably, has very little impact on a state. It would be one thing if you elect a mayor or a governor. It's somewhat more noble and less, let us say, dangerous for one to elect a senator.
That's the most Florentine explanation.
Your theory is that states elect people to the Senate in order to get rid of them?
I think only in this instance.
In other words, they exile them, Mr. Chairman. Yes.
I'm not saying that this is what happened.
After all, he's the ambassador.
It was an anti-Negro act.
the reason it intrigues me is there is still a strong tradition in almost in vacuo in Massachusetts that goes back to the 17th century and civil liberties and post-Puritan civil liberties. And this was a way to exercise that too as well. Now, I grant you it is somewhat Florentine, and I may be doing my former state a mass injustice. I just bring this up as a possibility.
But it opens up wonderful possibilities concerning how to dispose of local Kennedys, doesn't it?
Yes, yes.
Can I pursue one point that interests me very much, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, won't you pursue it, Mr. Buckley?
Is it conceivable, Ms. Hentoff, that what you really have is the following dilemma? Namely, you believe that the hearts and minds argument is not efficacious, or at least not efficacious over the short haul, mm-hmm. and we're interested in the short haul. Therefore, you are encouraging the Negro community to use a thing called a black power, and therefore to try to find means to maximize its leverage, but that any effort to do so might be counterproductive in the sense that untoward demands might stiffen a counter-resistance. Sometimes they call it a backlash, so mm-hmm. it's not exactly that I have in mind. But if, in fact, the white community believes that the demands of a particular minority are not framed in justice, then they do seek to erect walls that might not otherwise have been there. And this isn't this the dilemma that people like Stokely Carmichael and Floyd McKissick especially face, for instance, in defending Adam Clayton Powell. They turn around to people who may not have had a racist thought in their entire lives, and they say to you, the reason you voted against Adam Powell Jr. is because you hate Negroes. Now, that is a pretty provocative thing to say to somebody who's very carefully excreted a hatred of Negroes or any minority group in the course of his life. He gets pretty sore, doesn't he? And reasonably so?
He may well. I'd like to see
someone.
You
don't mind, though, do you? Hmm? You don't mind.
It's not that. You see, aside from Adam Powell, who I don't think is that, you know, he's, I suppose, in a sense, symbolic for the time being, but take something like the schools. If you're a Negro parent in Bedford-Stuyvesant or Central Harlem, and the schools are just as bad, if not worse, than they were 8-10 years ago, the sense of urgency becomes very acute indeed. So if you can do something to change those schools, it really doesn't matter what the white man outside of your neighborhood thinks, because the priority, the real priority, is changing the possibility of your kid's life.
Correct.
And that's where black power is really at. The Powell thing, maybe I try role reversal too well, but...
Let's assume the conservatives are useless because it is fashionable to suppose that they don't care about these matters. But New York has been run by liberals sort of forever, right? Mm-hmm. Now, why do they deny people in Harlem the help that people in Harlem need in order to have the best kind of schools for Negro children? Why? What's their motivation? Are they blind, misanthropic, secretly hateful? Or what?
I think liberals tend, by and large, to get bemused by their own rhetoric and believe that their rhetoric has actually led to some action. I think Robert Wagner was a prime example of that, a decent man who actually thought he had a decent administration.
And it was dreadful, wasn't it?
Yeah. And the way that happens is the cultivation, and this is not limited to liberals, but it's certainly endemic to them, of what Joseph Lyford in The Airtight Cage calls auto-anesthesia, which is the capacity to see all kinds of horrible things around you and not really see them or feel them. And I think this is, so far as one can categorize it, it's an American phenomenon, but it's certainly a liberal phenomenon, I think.
Do you really maintain that the Board of Education of the City of New York has not done its best for the schools of Harlem and Bedford-Stuyvesant?
Oh my God, go look into the schools. The IS-201 situation is really something. That's the school that everything was promised for. That's the school that was built in a black community. The parents were lied to for years. They said it was going to be integrated. And finally, the board said, yes, it'll be integrated, 50% Negro and 50% Puerto Rican. But we're going to have the best resources, the best library facilities and the like. And now, some 8 months afterwards, there are science teachers who are waving order blanks that they sent into the board 6-7 months ago. It's turning into another ghetto school because they simply, you know, it's not a conspiracy. They just stop thinking. After the plans,
you mean they haven't sent in the school? It hasn't sent in books, which
they have not fulfilled their minimal promises in terms of IS-201. It's not that they don't, they just don't think about that kind of situation once they've drawn the plan, once the committee is formed. It's a part of the bureaucratic ethos. You know, you don't really do things, you plan things.
Do you think that situation would be corrected by having a Negro school board?
It depends on what kind of a, first of all, if you had a local school board that really had some power to make the school accountable and would work with teachers, and I think this is possible because there are some decent teachers in ghetto communities who are just as appalled at the board as the parents are, and who also had, and I think, although academics don't always have answers that are very helpful, sometimes very seldom, if you did have some academics, let's say like Preston Wilcox from the Columbia School of Social Work, acting as a kind of liaison between that local board and the Board of Education.
You'd get faster.
At least it would be out there all the time, what's happening and what isn't happening.
You are watching Firing Line, our host, William F. Buckley, Jr., and we'll return in a moment.
Sorry, gentlemen. I must bring this most interesting discussion to a close. We are out of time. I want to recommend, for a fuller exposition of Mr. Hentoff's views, his book, Our Children Are Dying. Thank you, Mr. Hentoff. Thank you, Mr. Buckley.